The past weeks, we've been doing some messages that are kind of loosely tied in with the concept of stewardship. We talked a lot about the scope of our lives, the scope of our influence, what influences us, how we influence the world. We talked a little bit about partnering with God as authors of the stories of our lives. And all of this is a sense of how we're caring for the time, the passions, the talents that God has given us in a way that reaches out and spreads the gospel into the world. The last 2 weeks, we tied them into a sense of how that stewardship funnels into this accessibility campaign that we're embarking upon. And we take the time with so many different facets of this idea, because there's a depth that goes into them that really can't be, justice can't be given to it by giving a broad, sweeping statement about our lives or about stewardship. And so today, we're going to come and we're going to look again at another twist of this concept of how we order our lives. And so today, what we're going to talk about is our dreams in God's call, and how those two things connect together. And so what I want us to understand is, when I say dreams, what I'm talking about is the plans that we have, the hopes that we have that are generated by our own desires, our own passions, our own wants, maybe even our own needs. Whereas call being something that's generated by God. Something that is generated maybe from within, but it is God that's prompting us. It is God that is guiding us. It is God that is igniting that passion for something. And I think one of the differences here being that dreams have a more personal tone to them, where call is something that has a very intentional spiritual component connected to it. Now, the ideal that we have is if our dreams and our call line up. When our dreams and our call line up, it is arguably the most fulfilled, most contented, most peaceful kind of life that we are going to live. It is also the most powerful, most Christ-centered life that we can live that will help transform the world into the kingdom of God, which is what we're all called to do as Christians. So that's the idea. Do you think that happens more often by chance or by intention? That's kind of a weird question. Because you might say it can't happen unless it's intentional. I would say that most often it does happen by chance. And many times we fumble around with our lives and we're trying to figure out who we're supposed to be, what we're supposed to do, where we're supposed to go. And somewhere in that jumble, if we turn to God, we find our call. And then those two things start to come together. Now, the reason I say this is we may even get into an occupation or a career that is in keeping with what God has wired us to do. But remember, there's a difference between dream and call. If I have a dream of a certain career and I engage that career, but it doesn't have any spiritual intention to it, it's still just a dream. It's when I engage God in the midst of it and the process of it that I'm fully recognizing my call. And that's a significant difference between the two. Now, the reason I think it's important for us to look at this is because I can speak to this for at least the past probably 4 decades. I'm guessing that this was before even, you know, I came into the world. But when we hear children being addressed about their dreams, what kind of things do we tell kids about pursuing their dreams? They can do anything they want to do. You can do anything. Whatever you dream, you can achieve if you just work hard enough. We tell them to do what with their dreams?
Follow
your dreams, okay? Not hard questions. tell them should get in the way of their dreams?
No one.
Don't let anything or anyone stop you from fulfilling your dreams. Now, all of those statements are profoundly great. All of those statements have profound issues with them as well. We're only going to focus on one today, though, and that's the last one, which is don't let anyone or anything get in the way of your dreams. Because when we say that, and we don't include something on the end of it, then we are telling them, whatever you want to do, it's all about you, your preference, your desire, your wants. But there's a little thing that's at the end of that that we may not intend. Don't let anyone or anything stand in the way of your dreams, including God. You don't have to consult anybody other than yourself to find out what you should do, what your dream should be about. And that's where things tend to miss the mark. Is that is correct. We need to instill in people and kids the sense of when you know something to be right, do it. Go for it. But at the same time, we also have to remember that what is truly right is not dictated by me or by you. It's dictated by God. And so God has to be somewhere in that equation as we understand and encourage one another to pursue our dreams. The other question is, where does God come into the mix with all of this? Because without God in the mix of it, ultimately, our dreams are going to come up short somewhere. Whether it's in the contentment and peace that we experience, whether it's in the scope or range of what our dream does to the world in keeping with what God would have us to do and who God would have us to be, fulfilling our dreams does not mean being fulfilled. Now, to add some truth to this, have you heard stories of people who have been wildly successful in any walk of life and then later come to find out that they were really miserable? Maybe it took the form of being a very angry person. Maybe it took the form of being a very lonely person. Maybe it took the form of being a very greedy, unsatisfied person. Maybe it became the form of self-absorption. Maybe it was something to the effect of an extreme sense of entitlement or indulgence, whatever it might be. All of those traits are the mark of a discontented soul. Something's missing in those experiences. And so fulfilling the dream does not guarantee that we are going to be fulfilled. It doesn't guarantee that our lives are going to make the mark that they are called to make. Have any of you in your own life talked to somebody who, as they got on in years and they were giving advice to people who were younger, said, this all may look well and good, but don't do it the way I did it because I've got this, 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 and this regret. And you don't want to have that when you're my age. That's a sense of a dream that may have been fulfilled, but it may have been at the expense of hearing God's call in the middle of it. And we have to make sure that we understand that, because that is part of the key to our lives being as faithful and fulfilled as they can be. It's the key to our kids' lives being that way, and it's the key to the world being invited into that sense of a faithful, fulfilled experience. And these two stories here that we have today really give us a great example of what that looks like. Okay? You've all heard of Moses. He's in one of these. You at least heard his name this morning. But look at the story of Moses, all right? So Moses was the beginning of his life a fairy tale. No, the beginning of his life started out where it's like, we're going to throw this kid in a bucket and send him down the river so he doesn't get killed by the Egyptians. That's a very condensed version of that. But he gets picked up by who? Pharaoh's daughter. And so he is incorporated from the time he's a baby into the royal household. Now, if you looked at any of the Hebrew slaves at the time, and you had said to him, man, what do you think it would be like if when you were a child, instead of having to come out here and live into this really horrible existence, you were magically whisked away and allowed to live in the royal palace? Do you think you might hear something like, man, that would be a dream come true? Moses was living a dream. We don't talk about that much. If you haven't seen it, I think the movie I have seen that does the best justice to giving us some idea of that is the animated Prince of Egypt. It kind of pulls out this sense of what Moses may have been like or looked like or the experience he may have had growing into being an adult in Pharaoh's household. Luxury, prestige, authority. What was missing in Pharaoh's household? God. The Egyptians didn't worship the Hebrew God, which meant Moses didn't either. But he's living a dream. And I guarantee you that there is tension in his life despite that. And we know this because of his reaction when he sees the slave master abusing the Hebrew. What's he do to him? Yes, thank you. Yes, this is audience participation this morning. He kills it. Now, if he didn't have a tension inside of him, if he was fulfilled in living into who he was living into at the time, that wouldn't have happened. If he was totally satisfied, what he would have done is he would have looked at that and said, better him than me. I'm going to ride this thing out as long as I can. I'm going to get this whole Hebrew thing that's hanging over my head pushed as far underground as possible because I like the life I'm living. But that's not what happened. Something inside of him broke, which means there was a discontent that was already existing inside of him, and when it came to a boiling point, he snapped and he killed that Egyptian slave master. And he ran away. His dream wasn't the dream he thought it was at all. He hadn't found God. He hadn't found his call. And so he goes running out into the wilderness, and he spends a lot of time out there. I would argue that maybe this is where Moses decided and fell into a sense of maybe this was his dream come true, because he goes out into the wilderness and he goes out there. Now he's armed with at least knowing who he is, knowing that he is a Hebrew. But he's also now away from all of that tension that existed being part of Pharaoh's court and having to deal with seeing his people enslaved and also having to put up a front for his royal family. He's just out there. He gets grafted into another family. He meets a woman. He falls in love. They get married. He's just living this simple agricultural life. Does that sound like living a dream? Some people it is. Maybe it was for Moses. But Egypt was not far from his mind. Because when he comes across God, he comes to the burning bush. He's having a conversation with the creator of the universe. And the creator of the universe says, I've got a job for you. Does he say, yay? He says, no. Because if I go back there, they're going to kill me. So that experience in Egypt was still right in front of his mind. He still wasn't completely at peace, even in the dream. God doesn't take no for an answer. And Moses responds to his call. He finally comes into connection with God. He finally opens up and hears God's voice. He finally humbles himself and lives into God's purpose for his life. And all of a sudden, a life that had a scope this big, just about the royal family, just about his immediate family, that scope becomes epic. He goes back to Egypt, following the call of God, and he goes back with authority and a sense of power, and the result is that the Hebrews were freed from slavery in Egypt, and that freedom was not only for those Hebrew slaves, but if you look at people through history that have fought against oppression and sought to free people from that kind of a burden, Moses is one of their role models and inspirations. So Moses' life was not just about the scope of the Hebrews in Egypt. Moses' life was about the scope of history, even to today. Moses' life, Moses' call, when he lived into it, he helped the Israelites, the Hebrews at the time, get some organized fashion of what it means to follow God, becoming a great lawgiver. We see the words that he carved on stone tablets, we still see them hanging on walls. They're called the what? Ten Commandments. We still strive to live by them, even today. Following God's call, he laid the foundation for the nation of Israel. Laid the foundation that will one day birth the Messiah, Jesus Christ, which one day led us here. If Moses had followed the dream instead of the call, would we be talking about him today? Now, I don't know what we'd be talking about or who we'd be talking about, but it wouldn't be him. But we see in Moses a life that was missing God for so long, and eventually he died. What would have happened if he hadn't been missing God all those years? And then we turn to Samuel. Samuel's life began with a dream. His mother, Hannah, had a dream of giving birth to a child. They couldn't conceive, and so she's praying to God and says, Lord, if you just let me have a child, I promise I'll give that child back to you. Just fulfill this dream. And so she has Samuel. And when Samuel comes of age, she takes Samuel to Eli in the temple and says, here, I made this promise to God. I'm giving Samuel over to you, to guide, to lead in service to the Lord. Now, because of that, I think we can assume safely one thing, that at least one parent, Hannah, had raised Samuel in a sense of understanding his place before God. She raised Samuel to understand that he was born with a purpose and he was committed for a cause. She raised Samuel to understand that a sense of dreaming is good, but really the dream that Samuel needed to have was to live into serving God and finding whatever that call was going to be. And so Samuel, even as a youngster, when he's there and he's laying there and he hears his voice calling, he'd been put in a place with a mentor so that even though he was confused, he was still open. And he says, why are you calling me? It's not me. Go back to bed. Samuel, come on, Eli, quit messing with me. It's not me. Go back to bed. Samuel. Oh. So he's in a place where it was safe to express his question, to engage his confusion, and he had somebody there to guide him into saying, realizing, that's God. God is talking to you. God is calling me. God has a purpose for you. So next time you feel that, next time you hear that, don't come running to me because I don't have the answer. Open yourself up and say, God, what do you got? And so we hear Samuel's words that we sang this morning. Here I am. What do you need? What do you want? And not unlike Moses, Samuel lives into a life that transforms Israel. He judges Israel, he's a prophet of Israel, he's a guide of Israel, he is counseled by the kings and influences them, and he lives into this amazing life that helps shape this nation before God. because he lived into the call. Because his dream and his call were together. Now, all of us are either a Moses or a Samuel. I would say, you know, for me, I'm more of a Moses than a Samuel. I fumbled through a good bit of things here in my earlier adult years before I finally heard and listened to God's call. Now, some people fumble around, you know, into their 50s or 60s and are still trying to find that call and maybe haven't opened their hearts to it yet. There are people out there right now who have no idea what a relationship with God looks like. God's got a call for them. They just may not have the vocabulary or the inspiration to open themselves up to it. And there are also, I'm sure, those of us raised in the church, taught to listen for God and felt that call from an early age and just lived into it. I would argue that kind of life is, you know, it's not easy. You know, Moses and Samuel didn't have an easy go of it once they embraced the call of God. That's not what I'm saying. But there's at least an assurance in that path that you know it's bearing fruit, that you know that you're in right standing with God. And the question before us is for the kids that we have here. These kids have received their Bibles this morning, the kids that will one day receive their Bibles, the kids that have already received their Bibles. And remember, everybody's somebody's kid. So kid can apply into adulthood. But right now for these younger ones, we have the opportunity to help set them on a course. Are they going to be Samuel or are they going to be Moses? Are we going to set them on a course here and now that for the rest of their lives that they will have a foundation that says, look to God. Look to Jesus. Listen for that spirit inside of you, giving you the guidance and the strength to do what you're called to do. Or will it be more random? And then will it be a bouncing back and forth kind of a thing? And so, just briefly, I just want to remind us, there's just a few simple things, three simple things we can do to help ourselves and help them get into that track, get into that groove where a call is what we are seeking, where a call and dream are trying to be married. And the first one is really simple. We have to make sure that we're connected to God. We have to avail ourselves of those opportunities and disciplines that help us be connected to God on a consistent basis. Things like prayer, reading our Bible, studying the Bible, coming together in fellowship with other people of faith so that we can talk about what's happening in our lives and receive inspiration and comfort and accountability from each other. Coming together in worship where we know that when we're in here, the TV won't be on. We can silence our cell phones with impunity. But we have the opportunity together to come and engage God on God's own turf and listen. We need to be in connection with God. Number two, we need to humble ourselves. In a world that says that our preference reigns supreme, we have to set that aside and say, no, my preference doesn't reign supreme because Scripture says I was bought with a price. I belong to somebody. That I have surrendered myself to the Creator of the universe, and that means that I acknowledge there is one that's greater than I am. And so we humble ourselves to say, whatever my dream, what's the call? Third one is trust. Trusting that if we fall into the call, that our lives will reflect the greatness God intends for them. We see that Moses was not keen on jumping into the call of God. He argued tooth and nail. But when he did, what happened to his life was miraculous. And so we need to trust that when God calls us, maybe out of our dream into another dream, But there's a reason for it. And that if we live into that, we will reap the blessing of peace and a fruitful life that we could never have experienced otherwise. Had Moses not listened to that call, he would not be seen as the great lawgiver, the great liberator, the great leader of the Hebrews. He would have been forgotten as a sheep herder on the side of a mountain somewhere. Proverbs says this, delight yourself in the ways of the Lord. Anybody know the second half of that? And he will give you the desires of your heart. Delight yourself in the ways of the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. The important part is that there's an order to that. First, we delight in the Lord. Then, we're granted the desires of our heart. And sometimes those desires will change because we're delighting in the ways of the Lord. And sometimes those desires will be realized in ways that we just don't understand until it happens. Let me give you just a very quick personal example of how this works out. When I was young, I always told my parents I was going to have a massive mansion and they could live in the East Wing. That one's still on the coop. Then the dream became just be comfortable. I had a dream to be a chef at one point. I had a dream to help people through law enforcement. In fact, that's what I originally set out to do when I went to college. I had a dream to open a karate school. Life kind of played itself out. And rather than becoming a law enforcement officer, I got involved in social work. So my dream of trying to help people, God made that happen. It's not the way that I thought it would. As I got into social work, I started to get a closer relationship with God. And that changed to ministry, youth ministry. And at that point, my dream was I'm going to stay in youth ministry my whole life. I ain't going to seminary because I've met too many pastors and I don't want to be one of them. We call that nervous laughter. So things unfold and I continue to be in ministry, which continues my dream of helping people. I've always had a place to live. Different levels of comfort, but I've always had a roof over my head, so that dream's been realized. When I started working down in Baltimore, I was able to open up a karate school, which I then had to close when I came to work with you people. But here I am, now. I get to be with you guys all the time. Much to my delight, hopefully not to your dismay. I get to play chef at least once a year with a bunch of other chef wannabes around the barbecue pit with the chickens. We have a roof over our head and we're very comfortable. And I'm able to do martial arts as ministry without any of the headaches of having to deal with it as a business. Now, I look at that and I realize I've been off track in the past, and I'm sure I'm off track in places now, but I know that I've always tried to get closer to where God wants me to be. And I've seen the way that God has taken that desire to answer a call and said, I'm going to give you the desires of your heart too. Doesn't look like you thought it would. Doesn't bear any resemblance to what you thought it would, but here you are. I am confident that that story is true for every one of us. I don't know what your dreams are. I don't know what your deepest desires are. But I do know that every one of us has a call. And I know that God wants us to be peaceful in that call. And God wants us to be used in that call and to use our gifts and our passions in that call. I know that it's only going to get better from here. Unless I go absolutely bonkers and stop trying to get closer to God and what God wants, it's only going to get better. So I'm confident in saying to you, it's not just the story of Moses, it's not just the story of Samuel. But when you do the same thing they did, it is the story of you. That your relationship with God will grow, your fulfillment will grow, and your call will lead you into waters you never dreamed. Which means the question is, where's God knocking at your heart? What's that itch that you can't seem to scratch, and you know the only way you're going to get rid of it is if you just say, okay, and surrender to it? That's God talking to you. And it's my prayer that as we all go forward, that we will continue to listen to that and have the courage that what God is calling you, answer. Be like Samuel. If you're not sure what to do or how the answer's coming, ask somebody. I've got a phone number, I've got an email, I've got a Facebook page. If you want any thoughts, you want to talk about something, all you got to do is let me know. We can try to sort that through together. Talk to the spiritual influences in your own life that you trust. But know this, that when dream and call come together, your life will never be the same, and neither will the lives of those around you, because your call will transform. Let's bow our heads. Gracious God, we thank you for the examples in your word that you give us that show us what it means to follow you, what it means to take different paths to knowing you, to experiencing you, to understanding the call that you have on our lives. Lord, so whether we are on the direct path of Samuel or whether we seem to be wandering around and just sort of bumping into things like Moses, we ask that you would help us to fix our gaze upon you, to engage in the habits and the disciplines that open our hearts to hear your voice, and Lord, that when we hear your voice, to respond with a resounding yes. And Lord, we trust that as we humble ourselves, that as we trust in your wisdom, that our lives will take on new depth and new meaning and new purpose. In Christ's name, amen.